the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Unfailing love flows from His heart and heals my soul. In spite of who I am, He loves and makes me
stand to receive the family.
like nothing ever seen or heard. God and God alone created all these things we call our own. From the mighty to the small, the glory in them all is God's and God's alone. God and God alone reveals the truth of all we call unknown. And the best and worst of men can't change the master plan. It's God and God's alone. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? Of your love, God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let everything that reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. Oh, let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God alone, alone.
Good afternoon. It's with praise in my heart that I welcome each and every one here in the precious name of Jesus. We're here for the memorial service of Mark Caldwell, a dear friend of each and every one here in attendance, and many who are not here. Let us pray. Father, what a privilege of it is for each one of us to come to you with praise in our heart, even through sadness, of having one who has left us, been taken from us for a little while. I pray, Father, that the songs that are sung, the words that are said, and the fellowship that will happen will have your anointing upon all that's said, sung, and done. Help us, Father, to bring honor to your name. Let there be praise even through the sadness. I pray this all, and I ask it all, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Would you please take a hymnal and let us turn together to page 4, sing a wonderful hymn, How Great Thou Art. Thank you. Shall we stand, please?
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the tree, when I look down from lofty mountains grander and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
I ran into Gail last month at Kenistone Hospital, and I was there because my mom had fallen and broken her hip. And she told me that Mr. Caldwell was in the intensive care unit and asked if I would stop by and visit. So in the process of doing that, we got to talking, and I was telling her about the ways that Mr. Caldwell had affected my life. And she asked that if I would maybe share some of that with you today. As I began to think about what I was going to say, I was reminded of the beginning of the movie Chariots of Fire, where they were having a memorial service for one of the great athletes, and one of the fellows made a comment like, let us honor great men. And that's what we are here to do today, is to honor Mark Caldwell. For most of us, our parents are easily the most important people in our lives,
And as we get older, we get involved in school, and maybe we have a school teacher or Sunday school teacher or some other role model who takes on an important place in our lives. Mr. Caldwell was one of these for me. The first memory I have of Mr. Caldwell was when I was in the fifth grade, and some of us were called out to go to the school auditorium over at LaBelle, and there was this man in there, and he was giving us a test of rhythms and intervals, and I guess today we would say he was separating the musically challenged from the rest of us. Well, after we went through the song flute experience, the time came for us to choose an instrument to play. Remember, we had to go over to the old Osborne band room, and Mr. Caldwell was there, and Mr. Stanton was there, and it came time for us to say what instrument we would like to play. Well, I hadn't really made up my mind. I was kind of thinking about trumpet, and Mr. Caldwell said, why don't you consider trombone? And I said, well, okay. I found out later that he had lots of trumpets. What he needed was trombone players. In fact, he needed trombone players so bad that when time came for me to go into the eighth grade, he asked if I would transfer from LaBelle over to Osborne Elementary, and that way I could be excused from class and go play with the senior high band. And so I did that. I didn't know then, but that was just one, that was the first of many moves that I would make in my life because of playing trombone. We had a lot of memories and experiences in band. I had the opportunity to be the one trombone of the one trumpet and one trombone marching band practice rehearsals. That prepared me for things that were to come later. And then all the music that we played, I didn't think we would ever forget Leader Man Rag. That was one of our biggies. Elsa's Procession to the Cathedral was one of Mr. Caldwell's favorites. There was the Chester Overture, the English Folk Song Suite, Sound of Music, How the West Was Won, Carousel, many more. But the friendships that we made there were stronger, I think, than maybe the friendships that we had with others who were just, you know, regular classmates. Gail and I were talking, and I was making some comment about comparing bands to sports teams, and she said, there's a difference. You're on a team, but you're in a band. You know, I think maybe it's that intangible that makes those friendships a little bit stronger. I see some here today that I went to school with, and we were talking earlier. There were always the challenges that Mr. Caldwell set before us, and the competitions. Anything less than a superior rating was not acceptable. And we worked hard to achieve those ratings. In my senior year, it was Mr. Caldwell who suggested that I consider majoring in music education and going to the University of Georgia. While I was there at the university, I made the switch from playing tenor trombone to bass trombone. That opened up a whole new area of playing for me. In those days, there was a musical group called the Spurlows. I traveled with them for 2 years. Some of the highlights were taping for the Bob Hope Show. On my 21st birthday, we were at NBC Studios in Burbank. Thanksgiving Day of 1970, I had the honor of performing in the East Room of the White House for President and Mrs. Nixon. It was also in that group that I met my wife, and we've been blessed with 6 children. So that's another thing to be grateful for. Also had the opportunity of performing for 9.5 years on live television with the now defunct and infamous PTL Club. Played for numerous artists and shows, done things, met people that I would have never done on my own. It's only because playing the trombone. And all that began in a large part because of Mr. Caldwell. You know, suppose he hadn't suggested that I play trombone or hadn't suggested that I go to the university to major in music. My life would have probably taken a different direction. So I'm very grateful to God for Mr. Caldwell and the role that he played in my life. And while he's no longer with us here, those of us who were students will never forget him. And we're grateful to God that he was able to influence our lives in such a way.
Why do I feel discouraged? And why do the shadows fall? Why is my heart so lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. So I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. So let not your heart be troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose all doubt and fear. He draws me closer to him. From care he sets me free. Watches me.
I'm sure that what we do today is a good thing. Mark would be pleased. Maybe I should say Mark is pleased. Because I have that suspicion that when we cross that line into eternity, there we have an awareness of what's taking place that we've left behind. I noticed as I came in the building today, and if you haven't already seen them, I would encourage you to look at them on your way out. Some easels with some pictures and various pieces of memorabilia that reminds us of past years and Mark's life and experience with the family and friends. First met Mark in 1953. Rodney, I call him Mark. I noticed you call him Mr. Caldwell. And others, I'm sure, would have different expressions. The Lord calls him my child now. And it's good to see the smiles on the faces of the people in attendance here today. To me, that's also a good sign. Because we do remember the good things in regard to remembering Mark. When we first met, we had the opportunity to talk in extended periods of time together. And it was in those conversations that I soon learned that Mark was a keen intellect, having two bachelor's degrees, a master's degree, and a six-year certificate in his field. Had an inquisitive mind. He was always groping and searching. He had an extremely difficult time because of his intellect of establishing a simple faith in the person we call Jesus Christ, and the one on which we profess to call our Lord. But he had a fascination with the Word. And I was reminded when Rodney mentioned about the fact that he had influenced his life. You know, in Christian fellowship, there is a power and a strength that comes in Christian fellowship, whether it's a glance, a look, a smile, a handshake, or extended conversation that takes place. There's strength that comes from it. It's a necessity. I can't understand how a person could be a Christian and not attend the Lord's house where he can have fellowship and gain strength. Or a meeting together on a private basis and discussing the things of the Lord, which Mark and I did on a number of occasions. We cried together. We laughed together. We wondered together. His mind was so inquisitive until after one discussion that we had, he had read an article, a scientific article, where it was said that some scientists believe that there are a minimum of 170,000 and a maximum of 240,000 other suns in our galaxy, the same light intensity and brightness as our sun, that might sustain Earth, other planets and Earths where life might exist. And he asked me this question. He said, Ed, I wonder how many times Christ has already appeared in some of these other Earths. Or maybe has appeared the second time. Or maybe hasn't even appeared the first time. That's an intellect. That's an inquisitive mind. But he was groping and searching, and I think his intellect got in his way. And as we shared together down through the years, well, I could see him grow spiritually. And I could see that he was getting closer to accepting that simple faith that's required. Back when he first began teaching in Cobb County, he had a dedication about him that was unusual. To me, that's exemplified in those two wooden crates that he used to direct from. You'll see a picture of them out in the lobby. They were sacred. But he loved his students. He would share with me at odd times about certain problems that certain students were having and what he could do to help them in a personal way, as well as from the standpoint of being a teacher, a music teacher. I helped him on occasion when he was doing advanced studies at the university for his advanced degree on different projects. And during those times, as well as other times when called me one time and he said, Ed, I'd like to spend some time sharing with you. I said, what do you have in mind? He said, well, somewhere where we could be by ourselves and be quiet. So we established that time, and we met with our Bibles, and we discussed the Word. And there were certain parts of the Word that he had difficulty with. We'd talk about those things. But he was constantly groping and searching. I have an unusual anecdote to all of this. Yesterday, I was getting a haircut. And I told the barber, I said, didn't you cut Mark's hair, Mark Caldwell's hair? He said, oh, yes, we were for years. He said, we were very close. He says, as a matter of fact, I had an unusual experience with Mark one time several years ago. I said, how's that? He said, well, Mark was waiting to have his hair cut and said, the man's hair that I was cutting, we got in a conversation about Mount Perrin. He said, all of a sudden, we'd been talking a minute, said, all of a sudden, Mark spoke up, said, oh, you don't want to go there. If you do, you'll become addicted to it. And then the man left, and Mark got in the chair, and they got to talking. By the time they finished, well, he looked around, and he said, I didn't have any customers, so I suggested, Mark, that we go down and have a cup of coffee at the drugstore. And which they did. And during that time, the barber shared Christ with Mark. And right there at the counter at the drugstore, Mark prayed the sinner's prayer with the barber. They went their separate ways from the drugstore, and a couple hours later, the barber told me, he said, I got a floral display delivered to my barbershop with a note attached to it from Mark, expressing his gratitude for those moments they had shared together. Mark influenced a lot of people's lives in a lot of ways. Dedicated, committed. During all of that, he had internally had his own difficulties of that simple faith. And through the influence of his family trying to share Christ with him and other friends trying to share Christ with him, an unusual experience in a barbershop led him to pray the sinner's prayer, to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. So I think what we do here today is a eulogy to Mark, a memorial service, but it's also a worship service in which we give thanks to Almighty God for his greatness and goodness to us. There's one thing that I would like to share with you that Mark found interesting. The influence of one life. Here's a man who was born in an obscure village, the child of a peasant woman. He grew up in another village. He worked in a carpenter shop until he was 30, and then for 3 years, he was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never owned a home. He never had a family. He never went to college. He never put his feet inside of a big city. He never traveled 200 miles from the place where he was born. He never did one of the things that usually accompanies greatness. He had no credentials but himself. While still a young man, the tide of popular opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. One of them denied him. He was turned over to his enemies, and he went through the mockery of a trial, and he was nailed upon a cross between two thieves, and his executioners gambled for the only piece of property that he had while he was dying, and that was his coat. When he was dead, he was taken down and laid in a barred tomb and barred grave through the pity of a friend. 19 wide centuries have come and gone, and today he is the centerpiece of humanity and the leader in the column of progress. I am far within my mark when I say that all the armies that ever marched, and all the navies that ever sailed, and all of the parliaments that ever sat, and all the kings that ever reigned, put together, have not affected the life of man upon this earth as that one solitary life. That is the supreme example of the influence of a person's life. Mark's life was also an example of influence. And today it's, I think, appropriate that we take the time to look back and thank the Lord for the life of Mark Caldwell.
Scripture says, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. A wonderful hymn of victory on page 345. Shall we stand and sing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. For this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. For this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. I'm watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. For this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. praising my Savior all the day long. For this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. For this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. You may be seated.
I thank God for His Word, for in His Word is the strength and the assurance and the peace that is necessary for each one of us to overcome the sorrows and the pains that we in ourselves, while in this world, cannot handle. Many, many times I visit sick folk in hospital, and I know that often they have questions that I can't answer. Perhaps there is someone here today who has a question that you can't answer. Let me share something with you that I have shared so often with others under similar circumstances. If perchance I should come into your presence and you should say to me, "Pastor, I have received a letter from the one I love most of all, and I can't read that letter. Would you read it to me?" As I read that letter, you would hear my voice, but you'd know the words and the thoughts and the love in that letter came from the one that you loved. Now, God is the same way. He uses individuals like myself as His. But the words that I share with you now for the next few moments, God wrote these words. God made these promises. And as you hear these words, may they take you through the deepest valley and over the highest mountain with an unshakable faith that all things of this world cannot destroy. Hear His word. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. If a man keep my sayings, he shall never see death. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Because I live, ye shall live also. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. The word of God that we have just shared together is fitting for the one we are gathered here today, the memorial service of Mark Newton Caldwell. Mark was born May 24th, 1922. Mark went home to be with his and with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ just 14 days ago. Mark leaves with us his wife Peggy, their two daughters, Lainey Shaw and Gail, Mrs. Jim Jackson. Also with us are Mark's three grandsons, Jim and Gail's children, Mark, Alan, and Ben. Also with us are Mark's two brothers, Mr. and Mrs. Peter Reese, and Mr. and Mrs. Paul Reese. With us also is Mark's sister, Marilee Reese, and her man Parker. There are also nieces and nephews, and Mark also leaves with us many, many dear friends. Mark was born in the Atlanta area, in East Point, in the great state, this great state of Georgia. He was schooled here in Georgia, and he first graduated from a college in New York. Mark and Peggy were married March 14, 1942. They have been together for 53 years. That is something to be proud of, Peggy, and I'm proud of you and Mark. Peggy worked and helped Mark through college. During World War II, Mark served in the United States Army Engineers. Mark received his first university degree, as I said, in New York. He was also a graduate from the University of Georgia. He graduated Phi Beta Kappa with a master's degree in 1951. After graduating from the University of Georgia, Mark taught for 1 year in Manchester, Georgia. He came to Cobb County in 1954 as band director. Mark was the third band director that Cobb County had in the school system. Mark started with Cobb County in 1954, and he retired in 1980. Mark was a perfectionist in his work, at school, in his home, and in his help to others. Mark was a very dedicated and distinguished music director. The 1969 yearbook from Osborne High was dedicated to Mark. Mark commented that one of the highest points in his career of teaching was the dedication of the 1968-69 yearbook. Probably those who knew Mark the best knew him as a perfectionist for his commitment, for his dedication, and his determination was that he wanted his students to excel in life, to truly be the best they could be. A case in point. One of Mark's students was a young lady named Lori Bagwell. Is Lori here today? Lori was a blind student who made national news by her participation in the Osborne High marching band. When Mark was asked, "Was Lori your success story?" "No," Mark replied. Lori was her own success story. Mark went on to say, "Lori was a young woman with her act together. With her enthusiasm and her ability, I was happy and encouraged spending the extra time needed with Lori for her to learn the marching routines. I knew," Mark commented, "she was certain to make it in this life with all its challenges." This speaks somewhat of the inner man of Mark Caldwell. Mark took a great interest and a deep concern for each and every one of his students. Mark also had a wonderful sense of humor. Mark wrote poetry, wrote opera. He had a deep and a profound love for music. In his sickness recently, while he was in hospital, his daughter Gail would sing to Mark. She sang those songs he loved so very much. And as she sang, you would see a deep peace and tranquility come over him. Mark receives high points on all my comments to this point. All my comments so far have revolved around situations and challenges taking place while Mark passed through life while he was here with us. Yet beyond this life, we may ask, is there another life? While here with us, yet, and the challenges that we have to look forward to, was Mark prepared to face and answer all of these questions that we have concerning another life? I can say with enthusiasm that Mark had a deep faith. This faith was based on God's word. And I emphatically say, without reservations, that Mark could say, as the Apostle Paul said in his second letter to Timothy, I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is now at hand. I have kept the faith, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also who love his appearing. I would like to share just a few of Mark's favorite scriptures from God's word. It tells what Mark was like inside. The first scripture is Proverbs 3, verses 5, 6, and 7. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy plans. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord, and depart from evil. And Psalm 150 speaks so well of Mark. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. Praise him with a timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high-sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Another scripture from which Mark built his faith and that describes his commitment to our Lord Jesus Christ is the 23rd Psalm. Hear these reassuring words. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My dear friends, what the world refers to as death is not the end. It is not the end for God's people. It is a graduation. It is the closing of the eyes here on earth and the opening of the eyes in the presence of Jesus. It is a new life without sickness. It is a new life without pain. It is a new life without tears. Yes, Mark has graduated. He has accomplished what each one of us must one day face, and that is an eternity with or without the Lord Jesus Christ meeting us on that eventful day. I praise God that Mark knew in whom he had believed. And now I want to tell you, I believe if God should permit Mark to speak to us, he would say something like this: I am home in heaven, dear ones. Oh, so happy and so bright. There is perfect joy and beauty in this everlasting light. All the pain and grief are over, every restless yearning past. I am now at peace forever, safely home in heaven at last. Dear ones, do not grieve so sorely, for I love you dearly still. Try to look beyond our shadows. Pray to trust our Father's will. When your work is all completed, he will gently call you home. Oh, the rapture of that meeting. Oh, the joy to see you come. And I also would like to share reassuring words from God's precious word concerning those who leave before we do. Our God says, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not precede them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Has now been realized. No one's in a hurry, there's no schedule to keep. We're all enjoying Jesus, just sitting at His feet. If you could see me now, I'm walking streets of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you know I've seen His face. If you could see me now, you know the pain erased. You wouldn't want me to ever leave this perfect place. You could only see me now. My light and temporary trials have worked out for my good. To know it brought Him glory when I misunderstood. Though we've had our sorrows, they can never compare to what Jesus has in store for us. No language can share. If you could see me now, I'm walking streets of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you know I've seen His face. If you could see me now, you know the pain's erased. If you could see me now, I'm walking streets of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you know I've seen His face. If you could see me now, you know the pain. Perfect place. Oh, if you could only see.
I apologize. I failed to mention one thing. One evening when Mark and I were talking, he said, "Ed, if I should pass before you," he said, "would you see to it that my family is informed of the fact that I'd love to have my body cremated, and then I'd love to have the ashes spread amongst the North Georgia Mountains." I told him I'd be glad to do that, and I think that has been accomplished.
As we come to the closing of our service for today, I would like to share a promise from God's precious word with each and every one here in attendance. Especially do I share it with the family, with you, Peggy, and Gail, Lady, all the family members. This promise from God is to you as an individual, and to everyone as God's family. And our precious Lord says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. For I, the Lord, thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, Fear not, I will help thee." And now would you all join me as together we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Father, I'm not certain that we understand it. And if we understand it, I'm not sure that we really live it. And if we do live it, help us to recognize that life is eternal, that it lasts forever, that we never die. And now may the God, who is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Father of all compassion and the God of all comfort, may you comfort this family and each one here in attendance. And may each one of us renew our faith. May each one of us renew our hope. And may each one of us renew our love in your word and in your Son and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And now may the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace, both now and forever. And Father, again I ask and I pray it all in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That concludes our service. Please stop by the narthex and see the rest of the story that the family has prepared for Mark. Amen.